Turn with me to the 37th division of the psalm. 37th division of the psalm. Let us stand together for the public reading of the word of God. Psalm 37. Psalm 37. Psalm, a psalm of David. Look at verse 1. I'm reading this morning from the New King James translation of the Holy Scripture. Do not fret because of evildoers, nor be envious of the workers of iniquity, for they shall soon be cut down like the grass and wither as the green herb. Trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land and feed on his faithfulness. Delight yourself also in the Lord, and he shall give you the desires of your heart. Commit your way to the Lord, trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass, and he shall bring forth your righteousness as the light, and your justice as the noonday. Rest in the Lord and wait patiently for him. Do not fret because of him who prospers in his way, because the man who brings wicked schemes to pass. Cease from anger and forsake wrath. Do not fret. It only causes harm. For evildoers shall be cut off, but those who wait on the Lord, they shall inherit the earth. For yet a little while, and the wicked shall be no more. Indeed, you will look diligently for his place, but it shall be no more. But the meek shall inherit the earth, and shall delight themselves in the abundance of peace. The wicked plots against the just and gnashes at him with his teeth. The Lord laughs at him, for he sees that his day is coming. The wicked have drawn the sword and bent their bow and cast down the poor and needy to slay those who have upright conduct. Their sword shall enter their own heart, and their bow shall be broken. A little that a righteous man has is better than the riches of many wicked. For the arms of the wicked shall be broken, but the Lord upholds the righteous. The Lord knows the days of the upright, their paradise shall be forever, and they shall not be ashamed in the evil time. In the days of famine they shall be satisfied, but the wicked shall perish, and the enemies of the Lord, like the splendor of the meadows, shall vanish, and into smoke they shall vanish away. Verse 21, the wicked borrows and does not repay, but the righteous shows mercy and gives. For those who are blessed by him shall inherit the earth, but those who are cursed by him shall be cut off. The steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, and he delights in his way. Though he fall, he shall not utterly be cast down, for the Lord upholds him with his hand. May the Lord bless me upon his word, and be sanctified in the hearts and minds and spirits of the people of God. Let's pray together, shall we? Father, we thank you for your good word. What indeed brings encouragement to our minds. It brings refreshing to our spirits, revival to our souls. And it speaks us and helps to regulate our emotions that sometimes race out of control. But your word serves as a great regulator to modulate and to govern our emotions so that we do not get at the point of despair. Now I pray, Holy Father, you might speak today a good word to your people. It might bring encouragement to them and speak a clear word to those who never come to faith in Christ. They might hear how they can be saved by believing the gospel. And speak a revival in word to those maybe who come to faith in Christ and drifted away. We have ears to hear. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. I want to speak to you this morning, just for a few moments, on the subject of comfort for the troubled mind. Comfort for the troubled mind. Back in the early 90s or late 80s, I can't remember the time, it's racing these days, but there was a very popular song that said, "Don't worry, be happy." Landlord say the rent is late, he might have to liquidate, but don't worry, be happy. I remember the first time I heard this song, I was actually at the North Shore Mamas Skate Arena by Shirley's Club Escape. When they were younger, we would go over there, it was the best deal in town. They didn't realize that she skated I am. You go and you make one fight, then you skate all afternoon. And I heard it for the first time, and I chuckled as I heard the words of the song. And no matter what the situation was, Mr. McFadden's recommendation was, don't worry, be happy. And it was humorous. And I think it made its way to the number one on the charts. But the more I listened to that song, I realized there was a problem. The problem is that some people need to worry. And what you often find is the people that should be worrying are not worrying. And the people that shouldn't be worrying, they're worried. And they're unhappy. I met a young man this morning and I was trying to witness to him. And I said, have you ever thought about becoming a Christian? He said, no, never thought about it. I said, well, have you ever thought that if you were to die today, use the D. James Kennedy, and an explosive illustration. If you were to die today and stand before God, and God were to say to you, and I said his name, why should I let you into my heaven? What would you say? He said, I never thought about it. He said, I'm pretty happy. I'm pretty content. And the more I tried to press them about the need to at least give consideration to eternal matters and to spiritual things, he basically said, look, I'm not interested. I'm happy. I walk away, and I'm just kind of praying, man. I'm still praying that God might open his heart. To say, here, this individual don't know the Lord Jesus Christ. And you can't scare anybody into heaven, but I would think that most people give some consideration to where I'm going to go when I leave this earth. But many people aren't. And I'm amazed by the people that I encounter in any given week that the last thing on their mind is spiritual things. The last thing that they're giving consideration to is the condition of their soul. Oh, they want immediate relief from the pressing problem of the hour. They want someone to help to deal with a situation that's uncomfortable or inconvenient. But they're not too interested in hearing the real answer to the most pressing dilemma. And that's their sin that separates them from God and that alienates them from God and causes them to be under the judgment of God. They're not interested in hearing it. Maybe they need to change. Most people think if their situation were to change, they would be okay. If somebody else would change, then things would be better. If their environment could change, they would find contentment. But they fail to recognize that the problem lies within. Amen. The major problem is not the external circumstances or situations as real as they are, but the real problem is the war that rages within. In this text, David was a man that was always in some crisis. He was dealing with one crisis from the next. I don't know how the man did not have a nervous breakdown, and I'm not too sure he didn't have one. I'm serious. I'm not too sure David did not have a nervous breakdown, or several nervous breakdowns, and I'm not too sure that some of his therapy was the writing of the Psalms. But the way he found some solace and some consolation that he expressed all this stuff that was bound up inside of him, he talked to God about. That would be the last thing that many of us would consider to know. The last thing we would think about was talking to God about our problem, about that which was troubling us, that discourages us. And one of the major problems that's confronting people today is anxiety, discouragement, and depression. That's why when you watch television, you will notice how many commercials there are that's advertising antidepressants. Ask your doctor about it. Ask your doctor about this, ask your doctor about that. And I'm not suggesting that depression is not real, because it is real. It is real, and sometimes it's chemical. And sometimes there is a need for a physician to prescribe medication to regulate the body chemistry. But there are times when the discouragement that we deal with is spiritual. And the only antidepressant antidote, the only remedy, is a spiritual remedy. The only remedy is this fellowship of God. Now, again, I'm not discounting, I'm not discrediting the medical profession. I have a high regard, I have respect for those men and women who sacrifice to learn about the body and the mind so they can treat and help people. So I'm not discrediting that. But what did folk do? What did David do? What did Saul do? What did Daniel do? What did Ananias, Ezra, and Mishael do? What did those folks, what did Elijah do? What did he do when Ahab and Jezebel was after him and threatening him? And he was running for his life and lived in fear of his life. And Elijah was depressed from along the side of a brook. He asked God to kill him. That's not depression. I don't know what depression is. But there was no psychiatrist for him to go to, no psychologist, no counsel for him to talk to. He had to talk to God about it. He had to pour his heart out to God. He had to work his way through this thing, realize that God was capable of handling what he would have to say. And I think that's what David has to say to us. David opened up this psalm saying, don't fret because of evildoers. And so since he said don't fret because of evildoers, there are two realities in that one verse. One, that there are evildoers. It's like my friend often tells me, my best friend, David Frank, he says, now, he says, the first of all, I want to tell you, you are paranoid. I love you so much. He said, you are paranoid. He said, but secondly, there are some folk out to get you. You are paranoid, but there are some folk out to get you. As a matter of fact, it's a way of him reminding me that we are in a real spiritual battle. And we don't want to make enemies where there aren't enemies. But there are those out there that are opposed to any man or woman, boy or girl, who decides to make Jesus his or her choice, and who decide they want to make a difference for the Lord Jesus Christ. And who decide they will lift up the bloodstained banner and say to people, repent of your sins, cry out to God for forgiveness, and that the greatest problem that people face is a personal sin. The greatest dilemma that we deal with is our personal sin, and it is multiplied by our corporate sin, thereby we create an environment where sin proliferates and we have to deal with the consequences of sin.
Come on, right.
And so often we want to deal with the consequences of sin with another social program, with another initiative to try to mediate the consequences. And yes, we ought to try to alleviate human suffering, but we still got to deal with the root cause. The root cause of our dilemma. And so David says, don't fret, don't be anxious, don't be worried about your evildoers. See, some people spend too much valuable prayer time worrying about somebody who don't like them. That's prayer time. That's Bible study time. Help me keep it, Bishop. That's prayer time. That's Bible study time when you worry about what somebody said about you. About what somebody told somebody about you. That's time for prayer. That's time to study the Bible. Not time to allow your blood pressure to rise and your adrenaline to flow. To worry about you creating more health problems for yourself. David says, quit worrying about that if you're righteous. He said, if you're righteous, if you know your heart is right with God, and you know your desire is to please God and to serve God, then stop being so anxious and fretful and bothersome over the small stuff. And so we find that we're all fretting over small things. But he goes on to say, don't be envious of the workers of iniquity. Don't you know that envy can also lead to depression? It can lead to discouragement. He said, well, why do you say that, preacher? Because at the root of envy is ingratitude. At the root of envy is ingratitude. If I am envious against you, then that means that my preoccupation is with your situation, your circumstance, or what you have. And my preoccupation is with what your position, your circumstance, your situation, your material things. What that means is that I'm not being grateful for my situation. As my grandma used to say, my situation. And she said, sir, you got to deal with your own situation. And quit worrying about other folks' situations. God has been good to you. God has given you opportunity to fulfill your potential. So I think David's word of encouragement recognize that you control a lot of your own state of mind by what you choose to think about. If we're constantly thinking about how bad our situation is, if we're constantly meditating upon and we are totally consumed with the negative things that are happening to us, then our soul and spirit will not be replenished by the spirit of gratitude and thanksgiving. I wish y'all would help me with that. You see, gratitude and thanksgiving, it is therapeutic for the soul. As we are grateful to God, as we're blessed and thanking God and exalting God with good hand of provision in our lives for his hand of blessing that he's extended toward us, as we do that, that is therapeutic for our soul. Amen. It has to lift our spirits where we can see that we are indeed the privileged chosen people of God. So he says, don't fret, don't be envious, because the situation of the wicked is going to come to an end. It's going to come to an end. And if we're honest with ourselves, we must admit this is a difficult time in which to be a Christian. To keep your mind clear. As the old Negro preacher said, Lord, keep my mind clear. Just to keep your mind clear. Because there is a constant assault on your mind. To try to fill your mind with thoughts of lust, and to fill your mind with thoughts of materialism. To fill your mind with this idea that you deserve better than what you have, you work harder than most, you serve more faithfully than most, and why is it that others seem to be more than you have, or have more than you have in life, does not seem to be plaguing them with all the problems that you're dealing with. So it's difficult to maintain an attitude of gratitude and a spirit of praise and thanksgiving because of this constant mental assault through the media and the print page and television and advertisement. But David says, if you're righteous, don't be fretting, don't be envious, but if you're righteous, then just trust in the Lord and just do good. Just trust in the Lord and just do good. And be consumed trying to do good and trying to do the right thing. Now, I'm going to tell y'all before y'all get out in the community, you can probably hear some things this week, because I stood up for a friend of mine who I thought was being treated unfairly. As a matter of fact, I said something that was incorrect because I didn't have all the information. And I went to her and I apologized to her and I wrote a letter to her and I wrote a letter and I mailed it to about 75 people saying, look, what I said was not correct. Here's the real situation. But some people were not concerned about the truth, so they continued to criticize her unfairly and unjustly. And I did something myself, but I got on the radio this morning, I was in the waiting room. This person is being treated unfairly. The criticism is unfair. We cannot continue to just level criticism against people and no one say anything and remain silent. Someone is trying to do the right thing because they're trying to do something, and because we disagree with them, we decide that we're going to basically try to slander them by bringing up some accusation, and it is just simply not true. Trust in the Lord. Amen. Do good. And if you trust in the Lord and you do good, you will dwell in the land and you'll feed on his faithfulness. God is a faithful God. Amen. Your presence and my presence, and our collective presence here this morning is a testimony to the faithfulness of God. Amen. To the mercy of God. Jeremiah said in Lamentations, great is thy faithfulness, thy mercies are renewed each morning. If we would dwell in the land, dwell in this sphere of appreciation and gratitude for God, particularly during this time of the season, as we move toward the Advent celebration, which has become the most commercial day of the calendar, more arguments, knockdown, drag out fights, more people mad, mouths are tight, upset over something that has nothing to do with nothing. And a week later, they forget all about everything associated with Christmas Day. Y'all don't tell the truth. That happens in not any older in this church. Let me excuse y'all from having a problem. But David said, if we dwell in the land and feed on his faithfulness, and we delight ourselves in the Lord, he shall give you the desire of your heart. That passage is taken out of context. As he's trying to give comfort for the troubled mind, and he's giving us some advice, David is saying we should not be fretful, we should not be envious, we should trust in the Lord, and as we trust in him, we'll learn to delight in him, and he will give us the desires of our heart. When we delight in the Lord, what that means is our desire is to think God's thoughts after him. When we delight in the Lord, it means that our desire is to see God's kingdom come, God's will be done, God's agenda to be the agenda that is discharged. That is delighting in the Lord. Delight in the Lord is not laying down and praying, Lord, now lay me down to sleep. If I should die before I wake. Wait a minute, Lord, I don't want to die before I wake because I'm going to pray for a new car. He remembered the story of the little boy that was here, and he wanted a new bicycle. And so he went to his mother and asked her, she said, no, I don't know if you deserve a bicycle or not, but will you pray about it and pray and see what God has to say about it? And he said, that's a good fair enough deal. So that night, the mother and the son were beside the bed, saying the prayers. The little boy, he started to pray, and he went through the ritual, down, laid me down to sleep, I should die before I wake, so forth and so on. Then he got to the part of his petition. He said, Lord, please, Lord, Lord, please, let me get a bicycle next week. And the mother said, son, what is wrong with you? You don't have to talk so loud. God can hear you. He said, well, grandmama got to hear you next week. So delighting in the Lord is not praying loud to where you get what you want now. Delighting in the Lord is trying to figure out what is it God is doing? What is God interested in? What's on the heart of God? What's on the mind of God? And so what is on God's mind, I want to be on my mind. And so I'm thinking about things that God is thinking about. I'm concerned about things God is concerned about. And as I'm thinking about things and concerned about things and doing the things that God wants done, then God can give me the desires of my heart because the desires of my heart are consistent with what God is doing. And so God is concerned about people who are lost and don't know the Lord Jesus Christ. And so as we delight ourselves and try to connect with people to get to know people so we can share our faith across our relationship, as we delight ourselves in doing good as Jesus did good, as we delight ourselves in letting our lights so shine so that others can see our good works and not praise God but glorify our God who is in heaven, as we do that, then God will give us the desires of our heart, and those things that God gives to us will not hurt us, will be a blessing to us to help us to do God's will. So David said, one of the counsels for a troubled mind is to get the people of God to delight themselves in the Lord and to be appreciative and to be satisfied with the things that God decides for them to have. Realize that they have what they need to do what God wants them to do. A few more things and I'm going to stop. So he says, don't fret. Don't be envious. Trust in the Lord. Delight yourself in the Lord. Verse 5, commit your way to the Lord. Trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass. Let's stop right there. If I were to ask many of you, do you want to do God's will? Do you really want to do God's will? I think most of you would say yes. I want to do God's will. But then if I would ask you, are you willing to do something that is diametrically in opposition to what you want to do, you would struggle with that. You would struggle with saying, I'm willing to do that if it's God's will. God has a will. He has a will. He's not one of his parents, but all should come to the knowledge of the truth. He has a will that we live in sanctification and honor and holiness as the people of God. He has a will that we're not envying and and strife and division and bitterness in between family members and between Christians. And so God has a will. And so God wants us to seek to be in his will. The will of God is like the Kanawha River or a stream of water that is moving toward the ocean. And so what God is wanting us to do is to get in the stream. He wants us to get in the current and to allow the current of his will to bear us through life. And as we're being born through life by the current of the will of God, we will come to situations and circumstances where God can use us to do specific things. Specific things. The will of God is moving toward eternity. Everlasting life for the people of God. Everlasting destruction for those who are outside of the faith. But as we get in the will of God, there are then specific little tributaries that God will direct you to or your children to, specific things that God will lead you to do, but that only happens after you just get in his will. And your desire is for God's will to be done, even if it goes totally against all of your own personal dreams, aspirations, goals, or ambitions. Are you going to help? There's nothing wrong with having goals and ambitions and dreams and targets that you set for yourself. I think that's very important because that helps to bring out the best in us. It helps to focus us in a meaningful direction. But at the same time, we must be prepared to accept that God has the right to change the agenda if he so desires. Now, as I was coming to church this morning, I was thinking, I move further on in life, in a few years, hopefully I'll be living and I'll be moving into what I think will be the last third of my life. And it's hard for me to accept it. I still think of myself being 18 or 19. But I'm moving toward the last third of my life. That's if God chooses to allow me the 3, 4, and 10. And I'm saying, well, what do I want to do with this last third? I can't see much I've done with the first 2/3. We created 5 babies and tried to get them grown. But what do I want to do with the last third? And I really think the Spirit of the Lord spoke to my heart. I said, well, what I really think God wants me to do is to try to raise up the next generation, try to deposit something in the next generation that's going to carry on the faith. And as I was thinking about that, I thought about the youth of the Grace Bible Church. And I said, Lord, you mean to tell me that not one single youth of the Grace Bible Church is called to the ministry? We don't have no youth in our church that you have called them to be missionaries, called them to be pastors or teachers, called them to teach in Christian schools. We none of them are called. Do we have none of them called to commit their lives to you even as a child and have the focus of their entire life to prepare to serve God? None of them are called. I just can't believe it. I believe that some of the kids in here are called to full-time Christian ministry. And what we got to do as parents, we got to free them up to do it and give them our blessing. It's okay if you don't become the president of IBM. It's all right if you never make anything above the minimum wage. If that's God's call, if that is God's will, then you will accomplish more in your life of significance. You will do more to advance the kingdom of God than you would if you become the president of the United States. God wants us to commit our ways to the Lord, and committing our ways to the Lord does not only mean committing ourselves, but it means committing everything associated with us. And say, Lord, here it is. It belongs to you. And do with it what you want to do. And that includes our children. I have never in my life seen such a frustrated group of young people. In my entire life, just frustrated, angry, mad at the entire world. While at the same time, most of them are wearing designer clothes, started Reebok, Nike, FUBU, $100 tennis shoes, got palm pallets, all that type of business going on, but still angry and bitter and resentful and some of them just hateful. Just hateful. And I said, what in the world is going on? I know what's going on. The Bible has been fulfilled in the last days, unthankful, unholy. Hey. thinking he's going to do it, but some kind of way, God is going to do it because God is always faithful. He's never late. He's always on time. So David said, you commit to the ways of the Lord. He'll bring it to pass. What do you believe in God? Some of y'all believe in him for anything. You're not believing for enough to get his attention. Now listen to me. If you only believe in God for something you can do through your own human effort and ingenuity, that doesn't get God's attention. But you better believe God for something so far up above you, there's no way in the world you can do it. That gets God's attention. That gets his attention. Because when God comes down in his power and his strength and his magic and his glory, and when God's anointing lands on your life and in your situation, and when God does something that's totally impossible, then you will have something to know, I ain't have nothing to do with that. I have nothing to do with that. And you'll put your hand behind you and say, to God be the glory. That's the type of God that we serve, ladies and gentlemen. That's the type that we serve. And I come here Wednesday night and I listen to people testify. And I don't mean to embarrass her, but every time Sister Joan County would get up with tears rolling down her face, and I believe in God to save my brother. I know he's on drugs. I know he's addicted to drugs. I know he broke my mama's heart. He stole her money. He did all types of things. But I don't want my brother to die and go into a crisis. He's dead. I just want to believe in God. He believed in God. Even when God had to bring a situation where the man's body got afflicted with cancer and she had to spend her money going back and forth over the road, but God allowed her to see her brother come to say, hey, in Jesus Christ, and she knows about the power of God. That's what we're talking about. That's what God is doing. That's what he wants to do. He wants us to commit our ways to him and get up in the morning calling on him and believe in him and trust in him. You got a husband that's mean and cantankerous, just committed to the Lord. And say, Lord, he belongs to you. He's yours. I'm going to do the best I can. I'm going to be nice to him. I'm going to cook for him. I'm going to wash his clothes, Lord. But I can't deal with this mean, contentious spirit. You got to do something. So I'm going to quit fussing and arguing. And I'm not even going to write repent on the bottom of his solar pot. I'm not going to do that. I'm going to commit to you. And I'm going to believe that you will move on his heart. I'm going to believe that you will move on his heart. Let me tell you something else. When you decide to commit yourself to the Lord, let me tell you what happens. When you decide to commit yourself to the Lord, God just won't let you go. He just won't let you do any kind of old way. He won't let you have any other type of attitude. God will deal with you. If you really want to live for him, if you really want to serve, I just figure this thing out. If you commit yourself to the Lord so you're serious about it, but you're not willing to go all the way with him, God will take sleep away from you. Or you can't sleep, and there's no apparent reason as to why you can't sleep, but God just wants to talk to you. In the quietness and the solace of the wee hours of the morning, with no TV, no radio, no other voices, just you and him, he wants to talk to you. Well, are you really serious about that commitment? Are you really serious about wanting to see me work in your family, in your children, in your life, in your church, or in your job? Then you are the problem. It's not your wife, it's not your children, it's not the church. That's what God told me. I don't know what he's telling y'all. I just figured this thing out. I've been suffering from insomnia for months. I said, what in the world is going on? I'm just a young man. I'm healthy. I ought to be able to go to sleep at night. I get up early in the morning, work very extremely hard all day, literally physically exhausted at the end of the day. But I began to realize God was speaking to my heart on submission between me and him. Just between me and him. Ain't nobody else's business. Just me and him. Just me and him. And I said, Lord, yes, I'm serious. Well, I'm serious, Lord. I'm serious. But what I need to do? God has shown me. He'll do the same thing for you. He'll do the same thing for you. Most of our worry and most of our frustration and most of our anger and most of our bitterness, it has nothing to do with anybody else. It really has nothing to do with anybody else. It's really all right here. And some of you young folks, some of you young people, y'all need to come to grips with this. Y'all really do need to come to grips with it because this world system is just telling you a lie. It's telling you a lie that you're entitled to this and you ought to have this and you're going to make these type of demands and your parents are required to do this for you and so forth. Let me tell you something. something that looked like a Christian home. Can I talk to young folks just for a minute? See, sometimes the young people, y'all don't know where we came from. We came over people drawing guns on folk and throwing knives at people and cutting folk and cussing people out. All that type of business. And so we fed a whole lot of old cotton. And all we wanted was just to bring up our kids and just an environment where it looked like somebody had some sense. You know what I mean? And to get there, and we think we got to the promised land. Just to get there, we think we made it to the promised land. And some of you are breaking your parents' hearts. You're breaking their hearts with your attitude, with the chip that's on your shoulder. God wants to help you deal with that. He wants to help you deal with that. He don't want you going through life with this chip on your shoulder, with this sour attitude, this bitterness. He wants you to deal with it. And first of all, if you're not saved, he wants to save you. He wants to come into your life and fill your heart with joy. Put a smile on your face. Give you a sense of purpose and you're going somewhere. You're going to do something. You're going to do something significant. God's kingdom is going to be a blessing and help other people. Amen. You can be a blessing to your parents. And some of us as parents, we got to get rid of this anger. We got to get rid of this resentment. We got to get rid of this bitterness. We got to allow God to do something. And I know what you're going to say. I know exactly what you're going to say. But I've always been this way. That's the problem. That is the problem. You've always been that way, and I've always been, and that is the problem. And the longer we stay that way, the worse the situation is for us and for other people. But we can believe God to help us change. We can believe God to do something that starts inside of us. And what it will do is strengthen our faith. If God can change us, it'll be out of itself. Sometimes in your mind, you be thinking, well, I ain't never do no better than this in this area. But once you say that, you basically close the valve for the Spirit of God to help you. And you're settling for something less than what God wants for you. But as you keep committing yourself to Him and allowing the Lord to fill your life and to fill that area, and when you sense a nudge, man, I'm getting a little bit better here. That strengthens your faith. That strengthens your faith going to go a little bit farther. And it strengthens your faith that if God can deal with me here, then God can deal with other people here, and God can minister through me to help other folks. Let me close with this. I've shared this with you before. It bears repeating. We're all in some type of recovery, you know. We're on some type of some type of addiction, some type of dysfunction, and so we're all sort of trying to recover, and there's still scars to the left and the residual effect, and some are farther along than others. But see, but part of God's plan for therapy is that we help other folk while we get better. We help other people while we're doing it, getting better. And see, the way the Holy Spirit works, the Holy Spirit who comes to live inside of us in salvation, the way He works is that He comes and He brings a gift, the ability for us to be able to serve God. And He wants to work in and through us and that for that gift to work out. And as we serve other people, the Holy Spirit flows through us, and what He's doing to help other people, He's also doing to help us. You see? Yes, sir. He's also doing something to help us. Amen. And we had this little problem out at my house, and some kind of way this thing, Brother Mitchell, in the hot water tank, this tube, it was faulty, so it started to disintegrate. And so now every time the water is sucked up in the hot water tank, it's sucking up fragile white stain, little white stuff come out of the water. What's going on here? And so finally it got so bad to where there was absolutely no hot water coming out into the washing machine. It's only cold water. like my daddy, I'm not a carpenter, but I'm not a mechanic. But my daddy used to say, a carpenter I'm not, but a tack I drive. A mechanic I'm not, give me a prayer pie. Give me a person rich. And so I pulled it out, yanked it out, took all the hoses off, go to the back of the machine, and something like, you don't know nothing about what's on inside. And so I just took the hoses, folks. And come to find out, what had happened is all these particles of plastic had built up in the holes, and right where the holes connect to the back of the washer, there's a filter or screen to filter the water before it comes to the washing machine. It was totally clogged. And so no water, no hot water could get through. As a matter of fact, and my wife had been telling me, you need to change those hoses, change those hoses, and I would listen. The hose was about to burst, and water would have been everywhere. It happened to us once, hose burst while we were asleep one night. And we woke up with about 6 inches of water in the living room floor. And I thank God, Lord, I thank you, my wife would have killed me. I didn't tell to change the hoses. I didn't tell all that part. Well, I cleaned it off and I put the new hoses on fresh stuff. No, what I'm saying. What I'm saying is that our spirits is like that filter, it's like that screen. And the Holy Spirit is water, and this water continually comes through to flush us and to pour over our soul, and to refresh us, and to revive us. But when we allow the particles of bitterness, just one little particle sticks on the screen, and resentment sticks on the screen, and hatred sticks on the screen, and after a while, all of this stuff is stuck on the screen, and now the Holy Spirit can't flow through us. And it just builds up pressure on the inside of us. If the Holy Spirit can't flow through us, and the pressure is built up inside of us, eventually it will burst out in anger and crazy action. God wants us to keep the filter clean, and we keep the filter clean by confessing our sins to the Lord. And sometimes we just got to stay there and agonize the Lord and be like David. Just tell the Lord just how bad we really are. Just tell the Lord how evil we've been, and how we prayed and wish someone else's harm, and how we've been destructive, and tell God all about it so the next stuff gets flushed out of us. So the Holy Spirit can flow and bring joy and peace and contentment. Sense of purpose and meaning and a sense of vigor and vitality to our lives. So when we get up in the morning, when our feet hit the floor, we say, devil, you better watch out because I'm up. And I need business from God. That's the attitude God wants us to wake up with. We wake up, tell the devil, you better watch out. Because one of God's holy warriors is awake and available and ready for duty. Amen. If you're here this morning and you have a spiritual need to where your soul is clogged, well, maybe you've never come to faith in Christ. You need to know Him. Only the Lord can forgive your sins and take away the guilt and the shame. Only God can really deal with those internal, that internal conflict on the inside. And He wants to do it. And He'll do it for you today. If you would just say, Lord, here I am. I know I've sinned.